Never feel tired again. Yes, limitless energy, guaranteed, a proven strategy to never wake up tired again. How do I know? Well, it's simple. I use this exact method for real patients in real life in my clinic, and it's backed by science, a sleep clinic professional. You see, there exists an uncomplicated reality. The shorter your sleep, the shorter your life. The poorer your quality of sleep, the more diseases you will have. After spending a weekend with my friend who's a sleep specialist, my perspective on sleep completely changed. And I mean completely. You see, he works in a sleep lab day in and day out studying sleep cycles and sleep. And here's the specialty that applies to us. Sleep in relation to disease development. Exactly what I and you, of course, are trying to avoid. Disease states. It's called sleep quality. And how does sleep relate to beauty? Well, no beauty treatment, no skincare, no microneedling, no peel, no procedure will ever work if you don't have your sleep in order. I'll explain. We all try and eat well, maybe eat organic food, minimize excess sun, chemicals, and we take supplements. All these things, all this stuff, all these habits, all this reading, studying, all these life alterations to protect us and our families, and all to look and feel better. But this one neglected element is negating it all. That's what I learned. This is why you need to watch this video. Picture your brain as a bustling city with daily activities, and you're leaving behind, of course, debris and waste. Kind of reminds me of New York City. Have you ever walked around 10, 11, 12 at night? All the garbage is lying around the curbs waiting to be picked up. Well, during sleep, a dedicated cleanup crew clears away this mental, in this case, clutter. You see, inadequate sleep is like leaving the mess unattended and leading to a buildup of cognitive garbage. This contributes to the development of neurological disorders, disease, and mental health issues. For those of you into fasting, it's kind of like I call autophagy, and I have videos on. I'll link one to the end of this video. If those of you know autophagy, you know that cleans up all the irregular cells and debris that your cells are creating as waste products in the body when you fast. And this isn't your typical sleep hygiene video. Let's talk today about alcohol, THC, foods, and yes, sex. What is the effect of sleep on those factors? I'll tell you exactly what you can do tonight to actually start creating change. That's the most important thing. And if you need a little help during stressful times with, say, jet lag, increased stress, work, family, there's a little trick that always, always works, and it definitely is something I use and I need a little bit of help with, and I know sometimes you do too. I'm going to share that. But first, you actually want to improve your sleep. If you're going to do that, you need to understand why it's so important and why you have to start prioritizing it now. Now, I never did this, and I bet many of you don't either. In fact, for many years, I said it was a badge of honor to not sleep. And by the way, I often only got 3 to 4 hours of sleep. And then I visited my friend at that sleep clinic, and it changed everything. Look at this. Now, a lot of these are going to be shocking to a lot of you, the effects of poor sleep and sleep deprivation. Look at this, 6,000 fatal car crashes caused by drowsy drivers. 1 in 25 adults who've fallen asleep at the wheel in the past month. So there's a high morbidity and mortality, but check something like this out in the middle. More, right over here, more cravings for sweet, salty, and starchy food. And think about what that does. Insulin resistance, that affects, of course, your sleep in a crescendo effect and that black hole effect again, where one thing leads to another. Look at this. A 36% increase for risk of colorectal cancer, 3 times the risk for type 2 diabetes, less active immune protection. Look at this one for colds down here on the bottom right, 3 times more likely to catch a cold. Think of that, about how that affects your work productivity and, of course, your life. A 48% increase in developing heart disease, 48%. And then If you look at, of course, depression down here, irritability, anxiety, forgetfulness, fuzzy thinking, a 33% increased risk in dementia. We know sleep is so important. I could go on and on, but if that doesn't motivate you to watch this video. Now, at the end of the video, write in the comments below how many hours you're getting. I did a poll from my community part on this channel, and it showed that 50% of you are getting 6 to 8 hours of sleep. Nice. I'm wondering if that's real, but comment below. More on what you need and how to know if you're getting the real sleep in a moment, but have you ever wondered how you or our country stacks up to the world? Well, look at this slide. This is kind of a fun one. The average time that people sleep, 6.8 hours in the weeknights, 7.8 hours on the weekend, and the recommended, of course, we talked about is 8 hours. 80% of global adults want to improve their quality of sleep. That's how important sleep is. That's how big the market for sleep is. 67% typically wake up at least once during the night. How disruptive is that? Those are two high numbers. If we come down here, 63% sleep longer on the weekends to quote unquote catch up on sleep. We know you really can't do that. And 49% do feel like they get enough sleep. And interestingly, that's what on my poll on this channel, 50% of you said you're getting about 6 to 8 hours of sleep. Look at over here. Who are the most restful populations? Well, India, Saudi Arabia, China, and then yes, the US, Argentina, Russia, Germany, and it goes down. You can see the graph here. First, let's define our sleep goal based on science. How much sleep do you actually need? What is your exact formula? Certainly, we are not all the same. Have you ever seen someone you have not seen in a few months or even a year and they've aged? I mean, aged tremendously. More often than not, sleep is at the heart of this transformation. Sure, it could be work, it could be a relationship, kids, seasonal light issues, a little bit of depression. But at the heart of the transformation, the crux of it is lack of sleep. And then the disease sets in. Well, fascinatingly, the amount of sleep you need varies by age. You see, newborns, infants, toddlers, school age, they need more towards 11 to 14 hours of sleep a night. As we go to school age, teenagers, young adults, and into later adulthood, we need more like 7 to 9 hours of sleep. So here you can look at the sleep recommendations, and you can just see that they decrease over time. I think that's the trend here. As we age, you need less. So 7 to 9 hours, because most of you who are watching this are for your adults, but when your kids are sleeping in, they need the sleep. You see, we're all different because of biology, growth of our brain, and our organs. But for adults, it's more about the nightly blank canvas. Now, what do I mean by that? Well, think of it this way. Sleep is like a nightly reset, offering a blank canvas for the mind. As dreams unfold, the subconscious paints an intricate landscape and narrative. And then, just as an artist needs a fresh canvas for creativity, sleep provides the mental space for imagination and emotional processing. Sometimes you need more imagination and processing, and at other times you need less based on what you have going on in life. More stressors, you need more towards 9 hours. The less, you go more towards 7. But, and here is the problem we'll solve now. Even though you need more sleep when you are stressed, you end up getting less because of the stress. The black hole spiral at play again, and that's what I'm going to solve for you now. You see, the number one issue my patients tell me is that they can't fall asleep. Well, to be honest with you, that's just not true. You see, you are biologically programmed and built for sleep. Your brain is not like an on-off switch. If we go back to our primordial habits, the sun sets and we sleep. It rises and we wake. And it's based on photons hitting the back of our retina and either lack of them leading to melatonin rise, that's the evening, or an abundance of these photons leading to a serotonin and cortisol rise, and that's when you wake. You see, cortisol levels are the highest in the morning when they wake up and the lowest around midnight. Here is a graph of our sleep and hormone melatonin. This is key to understand here. These are where your melatonin levels are peak when? Around the midnight hours, okay, right in here. And that's what you're setting up. That's what you're setting up your oasis for. Look at the drop off here, and that's where you start having ideas in your mind. Your productivity increases as your melatonin goes down. But check this out. So this is 8 o'clock. This is where you want to take your supplement if you want to sleep in this zone. So here, I'll remove the marking so you can get an idea. So important to know your melatonin curve and how it peaks and valleys to give you a clue into what the time zones we should be doing what with when. This is why blackout curtains are a must at night. Now check this out. The Guinness World Book of Records for the longest time awake is, can you guess it? How many hours? Well, it's a man who didn't sleep for a record 264 hours, and guess what? He suffered the crippling effects for years and years after from doing this. This was in 1963. So you get that narrative out of your head that you can't fall asleep. The only reason you can is because you did not set yourself up for sleep. You did not take care of your sleep oasis. Let me explain. The issue today is that we have electricity, and worse, batteries, your phone, your iPad, and all the little LED lights all over your room. Melatonin plays a role here, and you need to set your melatonin up for success. Get rid of all the lights 1 hour before bed, and the little red ones, they induce a fight or flight response. What do I mean, fight or flight? Well, hundreds and thousands of years ago, if we saw a little red light or a shining light in the night, we would think predator. As a being, we were most vulnerable when we sleep. Well, that's still in our cognition. That's still a primordial response in our brain. And all the LED lights around the room, whether you know it or not, when you wake up and see them or they're flickering around, your brain is primordially triggering a fight or flight response. And those are the hormones you don't want. Those are the ones that keep you up. You want to know the number one habit that my patients have that scares me the most? Well, check out this graph of cell phone usage in a 24-hour period. Now, this one bothers me. You can see number of individuals over here and then the hour. And this is smartphone activity during nighttime. Look at this. The people are generally sleeping in between here. So in between 1 and maybe 5 or 6 in the morning. But look at the pillars on the right. Let's go here left and then on the right over here. If you see, look at this, 2100, 2200, 2300, all leading up to sleep, people are using their cell phones. Look over here, same thing, first thing in the mornings, you're waking up using the cell phones. Very scary graph to me. What's your to-do here? No cell phone or iPad 1 hour before sleeping. Get rid of any LEDs or flashing lights in your room and set up a trusted list on your phone so emergency calls or texts get through, but no other calls. Also, put your phone face down so alerts will not light up the room, and no reading. If you do read, by paper books only, that's fine. Oh, and yes, no TV. Now, what about sex? Interestingly, I get asked all the time by viewers, is it good or bad? How does it affect your sleep? Well, when you have an orgasm, your body releases a cocktail of hormones that help you sleep, along with sleep-inducing melatonin and oxytocin, aka the love hormone. These flood your brain after climax, and also prolactin as well. It makes sense that a chemical that contributes to trust and intimacy would also encourage drowsiness and calm, the opposite of that red LED flashing. Oh, and remember that cortisol? Well, sex also reduces levels of the hormone cortisol, which is associated with stress. Now, a power tip, make that to-do list. I call it the mind dump. Take a pen to paper and write down the goals of the things that you need getting done tomorrow. This is really going to protect your natural melatonin levels. And yes, you need pen to paper. Don't put a list on your phone. That one doesn't count. Did you not just see the graph I presented you on cell phone usage and screen time? The nighttime use is too high. The one that scared me too much? Right. Now there's yet more. You see, you have another mental habit that instills a primordial response. Do you ever feel your pocket and find out your cell phone's not there where you normally put it? I do that all the time, especially when I'm fumbling for something or I'm doing a task and I'm like, oh, I'll put my phone in my back pocket. And then I feel it as maybe 10, 20 minutes later, go, oh no, where's my phone? That elicits an adrenaline spike that says, wow, where's my phone? I just lost it. And now that's a new response we're getting from these cell phones. Why? Well, I don't have mine here.
No, God! No, God, please, no! No!
You see what just happened? That's the response you don't want. Fear of losing the phone. But I have it with my driver's license, I have my credit cards, I even have my money on my phone, everything I need to get on a plane. That's why you panic when you pick up your cell phone or you reach for it and it's not there. You don't want that before bedtime. Those are the opposite hormones we just talked about with sex. No doubt you also will be compelled to answer that text or place a like on your latest crush's social media post. So no phone. And if you do wake up at 3 a.m. with that wonderful idea, that groundbreaking idea that you have, it's because your creativity is firing up. You can write it down, again, pen to paper, and go back to sleep in peace. I do it all the time. Interestingly, when I wake up in the morning and I look at what I wrote, that idea was terrible. So a lot of times we think we have invented something or come up with the best idea for our next day, our plans, or our business, and it really wasn't that good, but we spent the whole night up perseverating about it. Wasteful, right? In a moment, I'll share with you why you had that creative idea at 3 a.m. It all adds up. Another power tip first, exercise. Remember how I told you, just go to the gym for 15 minutes. That's what you want to put in your mind. What happens when you go? You end up staying for an hour because you're having a good time. It's that you can't get there because you think, oh, an hour at the gym? I'm just going to skip it. Think about it as if you're going for 15 minutes. Well, I do the same for sleep. See, exercise in the day is proven to help with your sleep and you get a better quality of sleep at night. I use the same concept when I put my head down to sleep. I'll just give it 15 minutes of lying on my back, my teeth are brushed, of course my Rajani MD skincare products are on, and I'll see how it goes. No pressure. See if I can sleep. 99% of the time, I pass out. But there's more. You see, this next tip is key, key, key. The setup, you see, is paramount, and this is what I mean. Think of someone setting up for a volleyball serve, or a tennis serve. Think of Rafa. He sets himself up every time in the same way with the same habits before he serves and he's successful. You see, you need to set the stage for a great night's sleep. You cannot pressure yourself. I can't sleep. Oh no, I need to sleep. I have to get to bed. Make your room an oasis for sleep. I use my LED mask. I think it's because I feel like I'm doing something, like I'm multitasking. So it's like, it's okay to lie down. I'm looking better. I got the mask on. I'm doing something while I'm lying back. And I always seem to need to be productive. That's my problem. But this method allows me to sit still and console myself to the fact that indeed, I'm multitasking and I'm looking better for it. And I've learned to meditate because of it. You can use an at-home mask, like a recipe that you put on your face. I have many on this channel. They're free. Anything you want to do to make it like you're multitasking. I wonder, does the LED promote sleep? I don't think it does. I'll do some research and see, but that works for me. Anything you need to do at the same time that's soothing and relaxing, that would allow you to fall asleep. Now, if you are using an LED, you want one that turns off automatically, like mine after 10 minutes, you don't want to fall asleep with it on. But what am I really doing here? Well, I'm meditating. And here is where 90% of people fail on meditating and meditation. Meditation doesn't have to be complex to be effective because its essence lies in the simplicity of mindfulness. At its core, meditation is about cultivating a present, non-judgmental awareness of the current moment. Simple meditation practices such as focused breathing can have a profound effect on your mental well-being. A few minutes of mindful breathing can create a sense of calm and clarity, helping to reduce stress and improve overall mental resilience. The key is consistency and finding an approach that resonates with you. By stripping away complexity, meditation becomes a practical tool that empowers individuals to connect with themselves and experience the benefits of a quieter mind. That's really what's happening and why I'm falling asleep. Here's a mind-blowing trick that I use. Now bear with me and pay attention. It's important. You see, I'll go to bed early. For me, it's 9:30 p.m. Naturally, I would normally go to bed at 11 or 12, but I tell myself, hey, I'll wake up early. And that's the key here. That's what I just tell myself. It's proven we are more productive in the morning anyway. And in that way, in my mind, I'm at ease. I know I'll get it done, whatever the it happens to be, and get it done better early as proven by science. Now, I'm not a morning person. Know this. My natural waking time is 7 to 8 a.m. So here's what you do. When you have must-dos, wake up that hour early. Go ahead and do it, as you promised yourself. But here's the real kicker. When you have soft calls, things that you don't really need doing, you stay in bed and treat yourself. It's that treat, the potential of the treat, that is your reward. As humans, we need random reward. You will find this routine, this habit, works like magic to get you that more sleep, more routine, and peaceful rest over time. More REM sleep, rapid eye movement. It'll trick you into sleeping more regularly and more early, like 9:30 to 10 p.m., and regular is key for your what? Melatonin. Too many people are getting too little sleep and they're going to bed at 11, 12, 1 or 2 in the morning watching what? YouTube videos in bed. Not you, not anymore. Unless, of course, you're watching my channel. Now remember, I said backed by science. Look at this study. We are more productive in the morning. And look at this graph. If you ever wondered why some cultures, well, they check out in the afternoon, they siesta. Now check this out, stages of the day. And you can see our energy level peaks around mid-morning. And here's the thing, the trough is in the afternoon when people, in many countries, siesta. They check out for a reason, very smart. And then they recover around cocktail hour in the evening. That's why a lot of cultures, a lot of countries I visit, we eat there at 8, 9, 10, 11 at night because they siesta here. So it's another way to live, but you can definitely see where your energy level lags. But the key is the peak concentration and your peak productivity is going to be mid to late morning. But what if you're one of those people that when your head hits the pillow, your mind just doesn't shut off? Are you one of those? Well, here's a fact. When you set up consistent wake time and a consistent bedtime, then your body sets your melatonin and it makes a big difference because your body's in tune with your natural rhythm. It works. Another power tip, open a window. We had a snowstorm last week and I had to take a hairdryer to the window to unfreeze it. I won't sleep in a closed room. It really makes a difference and it's hard finding a hotel sometimes, but search for it. Of course, so many conferences are in Vegas and they don't open their hotel windows for one specific reason. You can't get in Vegas. Well, there's one hotel, but almost none of them have a window that will open. In the comments below, do you know why that is? There's a very fascinating reason. One key here is temperature. You need fresh air and you need a cool environment. That's a primordial response too. Now, let's talk supplements. Alcohol, weed, and coffee. I and my patients use melatonin. You see, the biggest problem with melatonin is the dose. Many of you are buying lesser quality, and look at what this study found. It's unfortunately Shocking. Now, this study finds that melatonin content of supplements varies widely. I find this very scary because the study found that lot-to-lot variability even changed, meaning if you get a manufacturer that's poor, you can buy it this month and next month get one, and it's all different amounts of product in there. But look here, there was anything from, let me clear that for a minute because this is key, from 83% less to 478% more. That variability is ridiculous. You don't know what you're getting, and many people think it's addictive or get nightmares or get side effects because they're on bad product. Real melatonin is great. You see, many people think melatonin is addictive, and this has been proven wrong. It's not addictive. Some also say that they get nightmares, but this is when the dose is high, way too high. Real products don't give you that problem. I much prefer a real combination low-dose melatonin product. Remember how important I told you melatonin was to sleep? And sometimes, yes, you need a little help. For me, I use it when I'm stressed, if I'm working a lot, definitely when I'm traveling, or I just can't fall asleep. For those who can fall asleep, it's best to use it 1 to 1.5 hours before bedtime. And this is what I include in my sleep extreme. This is exactly what I take. So you can compare it to yours or you can try mine. But melatonin is a lifesaver for myself and my patients. So here's what I like in my product. You can see magnesium. Many of you do take magnesium, 13 milligrams. Vitamin B6, of course, L-tryptophan. I want you to note down here, ashwagandha, an adaptogen, very important for balancing and homeostasis, decreasing anxiety and leveling out our hormones. That's an adaptogen I have a whole video on. Of course, melatonin. Now, it's 10 milligrams. That's based on, look up here, 2 capsules. So one capsule would give you 5. I often only take 1. That's all you need because we also have passion flower, L-taurine, you have L-theanine, all supplements you're familiar with, but a combination product with real melatonin, that's what you're looking for. Now, what about alcohol? Well, there's more and more research supporting how disruptive alcohol can be to sleep. Even one drink, I hate to tell you that. The issue here is, sure, you sleep, but it's an illusion. You see, your body's unconscious, but your brain is not actually going through the deep sleep cycles, the REM sleep, and it's not a restorative sleep at all. Alcohol causes less REM, more bathroom time, which wakes you up, of course, and less real sleep. You're not creating your blank canvas that I told you you need. What about weed? Well, the THC can interfere with REM sleep. Look at this study. If we look at sleep disturbance in heavy marijuana users, we can see here the marijuana users showed differences in PSG measures, lower total sleep times, less slow wave sleep than the control group on both nights. They also showed worse sleep efficiency, longer sleep onset, and shorter REM sleep than the control group. And caffeine, what should you do with that? We always tell people stop at 6 hours before bed, but it also depends on what your caffeine source. Your espresso will have 64 milligrams. A Starbucks 16-ounce drip is around 300 milligrams, and a full throttle Monster Energy, well, that's about 150 milligrams of caffeine. When I'm in Italy or France, say, I'm eating 9, 10 o'clock at night, and I do have a shot of espresso to finish. That's just custom there, but this is why. You see, espresso is quickly through the bean. So you see it had the less caffeine. But in general, if you're in doubt, think no caffeine after 3 p.m. Now that you know how to sleep, let's level your hormones and boost your collagen naturally with this playlist up here on hormones and adaptogens and one down here on boosting your collagen naturally. Keep your skin and body beautiful, healthy, and vibrant.